In the series of parallel transmission line, today we will discuss the microstrip transmission lines. Microstrip transmission lines are very popular in MICs and MMICs like circuit. Microstrip lines having different behavior at low frequencies and also at high frequencies. So first we will discuss the behavior, design equations and the simulation of microstrip line at low frequency. Then we will, in the latter part of this course, we will see the behavior of microstrip line at high frequency. So the microstrip lines is a particularly useful transmission line medium for implementation in distributed circuits designed at the frequency from 1 gigahertz to 110 gigahertz. So this frequency band from 1 gigahertz to 110 gigahertz, it is quite a large bandwidth. Lower microwave frequencies up to tens of gigahertz, so up to 30 or 40 gigahertz, we said that it's a lower frequency band. There is not a rigid boundary in between the lower frequency range and high frequency range of the microstrip lines. Now, one of the principal requirements for a transmission line structure is suitable as a circuit element in the MICs, that is microwave integrated circuit, is that a structure should be planar. If I want to use a resistor or a capacitor or a diode or a transistor at microwave frequency for MIC or MMIC application, that time it is required that the component or the circuit must be planar. So what is the meaning of planar configuration? Actually, the planar configuration implies that characteristics of the element can be determined by the dimension in a single plane. So what is the meaning of this statement? Now, what is the meaning of planar configuration? Let us suppose we have lumped elements like resistor or capacitor or inductor. So the characteristics of these elements does not depend on the dimension of the elements. That is why these elements are called zero dimensional element, or they have zero dimension. Similarly, if we have transmission lines, so the characteristic impedance or the characteristics of the transmission line depends on the length of the transmission line. That is why it is called one dimensional circuit or circuit element. Similarly, in the case of planar structure, the characteristics of the elements are change in two dimension, or in other words, the characteristics of the element can be determined in the plane or in the two dimensional structure. So in this case, if we have this kind of element, then its characteristics will change along with its weight and length. So we can control the characteristics of planar structure by its width and length. For example, in the case of microstrip lines, we can control the impedance of microstrip line by changing in its width. So this kind of element is called two-dimensional element or planar element. Similarly, in case of a waveguide, its characteristics are controlled by its width, its height, and its length. So that is why waveguides are three-dimensional elements. So that is the difference between zero-dimensional, one-dimensional, two-dimensional, and three-dimensional elements. What is the meaning of microwave integrated circuit? In the microwave engineering, we have bulky devices and components. So we have to require the small size, lightweight components, and they have to require the low power consumption, and also the cost should also be low. but we have to achieve all these characteristics by increasing the complexity of the circuits. So the microwave integrated circuit is a technology which replaces the bulky and expensive waveguide and coaxial components with small and inexpensive planar components. So the microwave integrated circuit can be incorporated transmission lines, discrete resistors, capacitors, inductors, as well as active devices like diode, transistor, etc. on a single chip, and the dimension of the chip is of few square millimeter in size. For example, we have our mobile phone, and in this mobile phone we have MICs or MMICs like circuits. They are very compact in size and we can carry this microwave device everywhere with us. Now this is the geometry of the microstrip line. We have our dielectric substrate, we have a strip over it, it's a metallic strip, and there is a ground plane, and ground plane is also metallic. So we have two conducting plane, one is ground and one is microstrip, and one conducting plane is at the bottom part of the substrate and another conducting plane is at the top of the substrate. So the microstrip line is an inhomogeneous transmission line because some of the electric field is in the air and some of the electric field is in the substrate. This microstrip line is a two conductor transmission line that can be considered to have developed the conceptually form of a two wire line. Because in the coaxial transmission line, you have seen that we have one inner conductor and one outer conductor, and there is a homogeneous medium in between these two conductors. So this is a similar structure. This one is outer conductor, this one is inner conductor, and there is a homogeneous medium in between the two conductor. But there is a problem that at this interface air is also here. So there is not a homogeneous permittivity. So there is not a homogeneous permittivity in the microstrip line. That is why it doesn't support the pure transverse electromagnetic mode. It supports the QC transverse electromagnetic mode. But it is similar to the two wire conductor transmission line. But at the time of analysis of microstrip line, we consider it as a pure transverse electromagnetic transmission line. The structure is open at the top, and because of this, it is convenient for the use in MICs or MMICs, where the discrete lump devices must be mounted in the circuit. And another good thing is that a small adjustment or tuning is also possible after fabrication of microstrip line. Now we will see the fields in the microstrip line. So this is the cross-sectional view of the microstrip line, and this is the microstrip, and this is the ground plane. In between there is a substrate. The height of the substrate, it is h. The width of the strip is w. The permittivity of the material, dielectric material, is epsilon r, and the permittivity of the air is epsilon naught. This is the thickness of the conducting strip, that is T. At low frequency, we can avoid the thickness of the substrate, but at high frequency, we cannot avoid it. The electromagnetic wave that propagates through this microstrip line in this Z direction, so it exists in two different medium, in the air and in the material. And at the surface and air interface, at this point, the field have to meet the electromagnetic boundary conditions. So along this substrate, the electric field is dense and confined in the material, but at the corner we have curved electric field lines, and some of the electric field lines are in the air as well as in the material. So these field lines are called the fringing field. That's a very important term, fringing field. This is fringing field. Similarly, we can also draw the magnetic line . The transmission mode in the microstrip line is QC, transverse electromagnetic mode. This is QC. QC, transverse electromagnetic mode. Now, why this fringing field is important? Because in microwave engineering, we have two or three kind of devices. There is a segment which radiates, that is called antenna. And we have a filter and transmission line like applications are also there. So in case of antenna, if I want to use or I want to fabricate a planar antenna, that time I have to require a large fringing field, because I want that it radiates as maximum as possible. But in case of transmission line, my requirement is all the electric field must be confined in the substrate. It should not be radiated in the air. So for the case of transmission line and filter like applications, this fringing field must be minimum. And in case of antenna, this fringing field must be maximum. So this fringing field can be controlled by the dielectric constant epsilon. So if this epsilon or relative permittivity of the material is very high, then the fringing field will be low. And if the value of epsilon is less, then the fringing field will be high. That is why in antenna application, we use lower dielectric value materials like FR4, RT duroid. So in case of RT duroid, we have dielectric constant is 2.2. In case of FR4, we have dielectric constant 4. But when we design the transmission lines or filters, we use the substrate material like aluminia, having the dielectric constant about 9.9, or silicon or gallium arsenide having the dielectric constant approximately 11. So we have to choose this dielectric material very carefully according to our application. In the case of transmission line, we consider this fringing field as the part of the transmission line. Means, if the width of this line is W, then this fringing field is, let us suppose, this is the region of fringing field at this side, and similarly, this is the region of fringing field at this side. So we consider it as the part of the circuit, and we suppose that on the both sides, there is a small extension in the width of the microstrip. So the effective width, that is W effective, is equal to the actual width plus 2 times of a small extension in the width. So in the case of transmission line, we will not use the term W, we will use the term W effective at the time of the calculation, if we are considering the fringing field as a part of the circuit. But in case of antenna application, that will be the part of radiation. Similarly, we have W, here we have new term W effective. Similarly, we have one more new term, that is epsilon effective. So as we know that we have two dielectric substrate are there, one is air and another one is the substrate. That is why we use the epsilon effective. So we will use the epsilon effective term rather than epsilon r or epsilon naught. So this can be written as C naught upon C whole square, and this term is equal to the lambda naught upon lambda whole square. So how we will explain the epsilon effective? We have electromagnetic wave and electromagnetic wave in the air and electromagnetic wave in the substrate. So the phase velocities are different in the air and in the substrate. So the resultant velocity, that is small c, that is the velocity of the light on a microstrip line, is given somewhere in between these two velocities and then expressed by the definition of epsilon effective permittivity. And this definition is epsilon effective equal to lambda naught upon lambda whole square. So the effective relative permittivity is less than in the range. So the epsilon effective, it will be greater than equal to 1, which is the permittivity of the air, and less than equal to epsilon r. And describe as a virtual homogeneous material that has the same phase velocity as the QC transverse electromagnetic wave on the microstrip line. So the another requirement for a microstrip transmission line is that the material that we will choose as a substrate, it must be lossless or it have very less losses. We have some dielectric materials that are used for the microstrip application. So there is a material sapphire having the value of permittivity is 11.7 and loss tangent at 10 gigahertz is 10 raised to power minus 4. The temperature range is also given and the dielectric strength is also given in two columns. Another substrate is alumina having the dielectric constant 9.7 and the loss tangent is 2 into 10 raised to power minus 4. Similarly, we have quartz having 3.8. We have polystyrene, that is 2.53. We have beryllium oxide, that is 6.6. Gallium arsenide, 12.3. Silicon, 11.7. And air, 1. So the major criteria for choosing a material for a microstrip transmission line is epsilon r and loss tangent. So the epsilon r must be very high and loss tangent must be very low. So according to these two requirements, we will select our material. So in the next video, we will see the designing of the microstrip transmission line, and we will also see the simulation of a microstrip transmission line on HFSS simulator. Thank you.